Mark Esper, Secretary Esper, thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate it, as always.
Yeah, thanks, Jake.
So let's start with President Trump said on Friday the Iranians were plotting to target 4 U.S. embassies, including the one in Baghdad. Other administration officials say the intelligence was not that specific. Was there specific intelligence that the Iranians were plotting to attack 4 U.S. embassies?
Well, let me say one thing up front first to your viewers, to the American people. The United States is safer today than we were just a few short weeks ago. Why? Because we eliminated the world's foremost terrorist, Qassem Soleimani, who had the blood of hundreds of American service members on his hands. Secondly, we restored deterrence with Iran, and we did so without American casualties. And third, we reassured our friends and allies in the region that the United States will stand up and defend our interests. And I want to thank all of our brave service members who are deployed for what they did, for their brilliance in executing this very important mission.
Okay, what about the intelligence? Was there specific intelligence the Iranians were plotting to target 4 U.S. embassies?
There was intelligence that there was an intent to target the U.S. embassy in Baghdad. What the president said with regard to the 4 embassies is what I believe as well. He said he believed that they could have been targeting the embassies in the region. I believe that as well, as did other national security team members. That is why I deployed thousands of additional paratroopers to the region to reinforce our embassy in Baghdad and to reinforce other locations throughout the region.
Well, Soleimani was a horrible guy, and he killed a lot of innocent people, and he killed a lot of U.S. soldiers. There's no question about any of that.
But 20-plus years.
But the question is not whether he posed a threat in an existential way, because he did. He'd been doing it for years. Mm-hmm. But was there specific intelligence that he was plotting to attack 4 U.S. embassies? Did you see any intelligence like that?
I'm not going to discuss intelligence matters here on the show. Let me just say this.
The president did, though.
It's the president's prerogative. But what the president said was he believed. He said he could have been targeting all those things that I believe as well, that the national security team believes as well. The important thing is this. Soleimani orchestrated, resourced, directed the attacks escalating up to the December one that killed an American. He orchestrated the siege on a U.S. embassy in Baghdad, and he was planning this much broader plot in multiple countries that would be bigger in scale and that likely would have taken us to open hostility with Iran. In fact, a very, very senior intelligence community official said to us that the risk of inaction is greater than the risk of action. To me, that is very compelling.
Well, the president has discussed publicly that he believed, and a belief is not the same thing as there was evidence. I mean, you could believe that Soleimani would have attacked the Eiffel Tower. That's not necessarily based in evidence. I mean, he could have been.
There was evidence that part of the attack would be against the United States Embassy.
In Baghdad. But what about the 4 embassies?
I'm not going to discuss intelligence. What the president said was he believed it probably could have been. He didn't cite intelligence.
He said it was his belief, but I mean, I guess the important matter here is, look, no one is disputing that Soleimani posed an existential threat to innocent people. But the president came out and said that he believed there was a threat to 4 embassies. Were those 4 embassies alerted that there was a threat to them?
All the embassies were alerted. That's why I deployed additional troops to the region. And let me say this much, Jake. I'm glad we're having this discussion today, because I'd rather be here discussing this topic with you than going up to Dover Air Force Base and standing there while flag-draped coffins come home. And I have to explain to husbands and wives, sons and daughters, why their service member died when I had information that could have prevented that from happening.
But I guess the point is, what information?
Had information that he was orchestrating an attack.
But you're orchestrating something, but you don't know what it was.
Orchestrating attack, likely which would include an attack on the United States Embassy.
In Baghdad.
It was going to occur.
But did the Baghdad Embassy know that there was a threat to them?
Absolutely, because of course they were already under siege by Soleimani.
But a new threat, I mean, a different threat.
The embassy was constantly watching the attacks, the threat streams coming at them, our commanders on the ground. I deployed hundreds of additional soldiers. We had Apache helicopters in the air to deter the attacks and prepare to defend. We had armed drones in the air to do that. Our goal is to protect the American people.
Sure, but many members of Congress from both parties have said that none of the briefings mentioned threats to 4 U.S. embassies. Why is President Trump telling this to Fox News, but the administration is not briefing Congress on this threat of 4 embassies, unless there was actually no specific intelligence that there was a threat to 4 embassies?
The president never said there was specific intelligence to 4 different
embassies. He said he believed it.
And I believed it, too.
What 4 embassies? What, you believe that?
I believe there were threats to multiple embassies. That's why we reinforced embassies with additional troops.
Well, here's the thing. Here's why it matters, because it might sound to some people that we're just talking, like, obviously Soleimani was a bad guy and he killed innocent people. We know that. But the question about whether or not the intelligence is what the president is saying is not a new debate. Remove this president from the discussion. You've been around as of high. Take a look at what Congressman Justin Amash, former Republican, now independent from Michigan, tweeted on Friday. Quote, when President Trump lies or embellishes on a topic this sensitive and administration officials then parrot his claims to avoid drawing his ire, the situation becomes extremely dangerous for our troops and the American people. Is President Trump embellishing?
I don't believe so. Look, the bottom line is we had exquisite intelligence that can only be shared with the Gang of Eight. So I understand the frustration of many members of Congress, but was shared with that Gang of Eight. I spoke to one of the briefers. One of the briefers told me was that most, nearly all the members of that Gang of Eight believed that the intelligence was persuasive as well and that it should not be shared with the broader membership because of the concerns that it could be released, reveal our sources and methods. At the end of the day,
President Trump said it on TV on Friday.
Soleimani was planning an attack, a broader attack against multiple sites to include embassy, and at least the United States Embassy in Baghdad, and that it was going to result in open hostilities. Taking him off the battlefield, a legitimate military target, was the right thing to do.
Well, first of all, what you're saying is not the same thing that President Trump said. President Trump said he believed there were four U.S. embassies targeted. You're talking about something else, one embassy and maybe a broader threat to others. Second of all, you're saying that you couldn't tell something to Congress that President Trump was willing to say to Fox News. And that doesn't really make a lot of sense.
We briefed Congress, the Gang of Eight, who are the legitimate representatives of the broader Congress in affairs like this when you have exquisite intelligence. They were briefed. I'm not going to go into details of what they were briefed, partly because I wasn't there.
Let's talk about the word imminent. You have not, as far as I can tell, used the word imminent to describe these attacks. Several other administration officials have. Do you think the threat was real. Do you believe it was imminent?
In my definition, yes. I think that the attack was days away. He had a proven track record of executing attacks and killing Americans. It was going to be in multiple sites. It was described as being much bigger, I think, for all those reasons. And the fact that a senior intelligence official said, the risk of inaction is greater than the risk of action.
Right.
Compelling for me.
That's what Gina Haspel, the director of the CIA, said, according to the New York Times. So you're basically confirming that. So here's a question for you. What you're describing sounds like an all-out declaration of war by Iran. If Iran were to attack the U.S. embassy in Baghdad and also stage this widespread attack, and you believe it was going to happen within days, would that not be Iran launching the first shot in a war between the United States and Iran?
Well, look, Iran has been attacking the United States through its proxy militias for 40 years now.
Sure, of course, but on a lower level,
right? Go back to last summer. I had to deploy 14,000 additional soldiers to the region since May. They shot down an armed drone. They were striking Saudi Aramco oil fields in the fall. They were seizing tankers. The scale and scope of attacks against our forces in the late fall had escalated considerably.
Absolutely, but you're describing a more grandiose, if you'll pardon the use of the word grandiose, a wider spread and more shocking and more bloody attack than the ones you just described. I mean, would that not be Iran declaring war on the United States if what you're saying is accurate?
Well, it could be. That's why I think the compelling action was to disrupt the attack by taking out Soleimani, a known terrorist leader of a terrorist organization who was on the ground meeting with another terrorist leader. Taking him out disrupted the attack. It also reset deterrence with Iran, and it made clear that we weren't going to tolerate this type of behavior.
You know how Iran does this. When the IDF took out the head of Hezbollah, a month later, Iranians are suspected in killing a lot of innocent people at a Jewish center in Argentina. And then 2 years later, they did it again. Do you think that Iran poses no more threat to the United States? Are you bracing yourself for something from one of their proxies, a terrorist group or a militia?
I think in terms of direct state action, it is far less of a threat today than it was some time ago. But I think they will continue this malign behavior that they have throughout the world for 40 years. And I think our watchword is vigilance. We have to remain vigilant. What we got to do, though, is get back to a position where they will come sit down with us. We can talk about how we get Iran to act like and behave like a normal country. That's what all of us want. That's what the regional partners want. That's what the Europeans want, is get Iran to behave like a normal country, which means no nuclear weapons program, no long-range ballistic missiles, no hostage-taking, and no support of proxy groups that are spreading mischief from Yemen and Iraq and Syria to Africa to Afghanistan.
Thousands of Iranians took the streets, as we noted in our opener, to protest the regime last night after Iran admitted that it had shot down that Ukrainian passenger plane. They say it was unintentional and due to human air. It killed dozens of Canadians, Iranians, Swedish, German, British citizens as well. Do you believe that it was an accident, that it was unintentional?
Well, terrible tragedy. 176 lives lost from many countries, as you just said. My hunch is it was an accident. And I was dismayed that their first reaction was to blame it as American propaganda or some type of mechanical failure. I think they did the right thing by admitting it. Now they need to allow the investigators in and take responsibility. But you hit on the most important thing. So in the last 24, 48 hours, thousands upon thousands of Iranians in the streets, not just in Tehran, but all across the country, saying death to the Ayatollah, chanting that America is not our enemy. What the Iranian people want is freedom, prosperity. They don't want a regime that wants to continue with this type of bad behavior all throughout the region, expending what money could be should be shared and invested back into the Iranian people.